reminder that we have a God that we can look to through dark times and cloudy times, that we have a God who can direct us into the right path. And so let's sing with us this morning.
In my wrestling, in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In my questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you, oh, my lighthouse, my lighthouse. I will trust a promise, you will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore. Tomorrow brings, with each morning I'll rise and sing. My God's love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you, oh, my lighthouse, my lighthouse. I will trust a promise, you will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore. For us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storms. Fire before us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storms. Fire before us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storms. Fire before us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storms. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you, oh, my lighthouse, I will trust a promise, you will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore.
This passage Josh had mentioned earlier, his prayer and our prayers also is that we, through this time, that we would learn how to love just as Jesus loved us. And through these dark times and times of desperation for a lot of people, you know, as we sing this next song, let's sing it as a prayer from our hearts.
I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes.
I see his love and mercy washing over all our sins. The people sing, the people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, I see a near revival stirring as we pray and seek. We're on our knees, we're on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. And heal my heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. And break my heart for what breaks yours. And everything I am for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. 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 He said, I heal my heart and make it clean. And heal my heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity.
Father, we do just thank you for being a God who's eternal, and that eternity resides in our hearts through your Spirit and in your grace, and that amidst all situations, you are Lord of all. And we just want to praise you this morning. We just want to stop, reflect, and give all we are to you this morning and ask that you would be lifted up as holy and that everything would be holy unto you. In your name, amen. By the way, if you're new with us, I do want to invite you to get to know us a little bit. So I thought, wow, how do we share who we are as a church with people that have never actually come to one of our gatherings? Well, first of all, V and Daniel would be smiling under the masks. So that's the first thing, is you'd see smiles. You would walk through the door, and somebody would be hugging you, although now, no touchy, but we would be hugging you, or somebody hugs, we have a group hugs, if you like that thing. If you don't, we'd stay our distance. You'd have people talking to you, welcoming you. We're actually a very friendly church. One of the things people have always said is that I just love that you guys love people. In fact, we care about people. And so as you get to know the church through YouTube and through our social media and other things, I pray that you find yourself welcome whenever in the future you see us again gathering like that. Also, I want to say thank you to those who helped the Barbers move into town. They're officially moved in. They're kind of unpiling from the boxes, but they are officially here. So, woo, good for that. And we are in a series on heaven. And today's message, it was one that kind of grew on me, you might say. Eventually, you're going to have to get into the book of Revelation when you talk about heaven. But what's interesting about Revelation is Revelation is mainly about an event in heaven. It's not mainly about what we do in heaven and how heaven is for us. It's about an event. In fact, it's called apocalyptic literature because it deals mainly with the horsemen, the plagues, the bowls, the things that are poured out. What heaven is mainly about in the New Testament is Jesus. And we learn more about heaven through Jesus in the New Testament than anywhere. In fact, when John writes Revelation, the first person he meets walking among the lampstands with seven stars in hand, speaking to the seven churches, is Jesus. It's fascinating that even as you're introduced to Jesus, both as he was on earth speaking of heaven and in eternity speaking to heaven, he had such an impact on a believer's view, a follower of Christ's view on heaven. If you don't understand Jesus, you will never understand heaven. Because really, he's the one that went to prepare a place for us. He's the one that gathers people to him. He's the one, as even as he's being crucified with the thief on the cross, says, "Today you'll be with me in paradise." He's the one that defines heaven for us, not we defining heaven. And I think that that's part of the journey you need to take. That's part of the journey I think all of us need to have in life, is discovering Jesus in such a way that you're brought in to see a little bit of heaven. So today, it's interesting, we're in these fires, and the fires are raging all over, and God has blessed us in the sense that these fires have not swept through any cities the way they have before. They have displaced a lot of people. But one thing about the smoke, I don't know if you've seen the smoke, you probably have. In fact, one of the ways you could tell you're in the fire zone is by how far you can see through the smoke. How clear is your view? You know, like I look across the straits, I can't see Diablo. Sometimes I can't even see the straits, depending on how the smoke is. And your view of things matters. Because if your view is limited, then it's also clouded. And what happens with Christians, I've found, especially in today's world, is we have a very clouded view of Christ. We have a very limited view of Christ because we don't see heaven. And yet Christ told us differently. Let's take a look at the heart of a follower of Jesus, Paul. And we're going to focus in Revelation today, but I want to show you sort of how the impact of Jesus affects every follower of Jesus. This was before. Paul probably didn't even know about this letter of Revelation yet. He didn't have the picture that John had been given. But he had Philippians. He had Philippi. He had the church he was writing to this, and he had the Holy Spirit in him. And in Philippians chapter 1, verse 22 through 27, he says this: "If I am to go on living in the body," because he was in and out of prison, suffering hardship, "if I'm going to be living in this body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. I'm going to use this life, this body, to do fruitful things for the Lord. Yet what will I choose? I don't know. I don't know what I want to choose. I'm torn between two things. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far than anything you will ever experience on earth. Better. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain, and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith. You see, Paul already had the joy of his faith. So that through my being with you again, you're boasting in Christ Jesus, not about yourselves, not about what you've done, but what Christ is doing, will abound on account of me. But this is the statement I think that should be a statement of every Christian today, everybody that follows Jesus today, in our church today. This should be a statement you should be able to understand. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, no matter what happens. You see, the point here is every believer in Jesus Christ conducts their lives in a view of a new heaven and earth. We all sort of stand with heaven in our hearts. We have a heavenly perspective of things. I mean, the question is, are you looking at something new? Because people sit there and they get troubled by and disturbed by so many things. And I sit there and I go, hold on. Who's in charge? The fires. Crazy fires. Hundreds, thousands started by a freak thunderstorm. Was it really? Or was it God's thunderstorm where God said it's time for the fires? Oh, the virus, it's destroying. Yeah, I understand that. But did God allow it, maybe even do it for the sake of maybe us showing our colors, testing us? Oh, the politics, the government. How much have we trusted in men? You see, there's so many humanists that call themselves Christians, it scares me. They actually believe that we're the ones that are going to stop all the fires. We're the ones that are going to stop all the viruses. We're the ones that are going to set all governments straight. The reality is when you read Revelation, when you look at Jesus, there's only one person who has the power to stop and do all those things rightly. And that, my friends, is Jesus. Now, does that mean we don't want good government? No. Does that mean we don't want to stop the fires? No. Does that mean we don't want to stop the disease? No. What that means is, who do you trust in? You see, can you see heaven from where you're standing right now? Or are you consumed with a fire, a virus, politics, hate, trouble, anger? You see, Paul, when he writes his brief glimpse into Christ, he says basically, I stay here because I know it'll bring you joy, and I'm filled with joy. I don't have to have something else in my life to fulfill me because I'm filled with a view of heaven and Jesus Christ. As a follower of Jesus Christ, are you looking for something new? Do you have your eyes on the right things right now? So let's take a look at heaven. In fact, really, you don't see a picture of sort of what the new earth, the new heaven will look like till chapter 21 and 22 of Revelation. And as you turn there, take a look at Revelation 21, 1 through 5. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. John is taken up in the spirit by an angel, and he sees this new heaven, a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth, they passed away. There was no longer even any sea. I saw the holy city, the New Jerusalem. It was coming down out of heaven from God. It was prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eye. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. The old order of things has passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. If you follow Jesus, you are always looking for a moment where everything will be made new. We strive on this earth to simply show people the way to what is truly lasting and eternal. We strive to show people the way through Christ. But to do that, you have to experience something new in your life. If this is all there is, then a sense, then what is your meaning? I love the way he puts the old order of things passes away. We would call this the laws of nature pass away. All the laws of science pass away. All the things that we know on this earth pass away. And the reason I say that is because you see this new heavens and this new earth, no matter when you think they are, how they are, or if it's this earth reformed, it's going to be something unlike anything we've ever known. And the reason is because of all the things that are not there. There are no tears. What has made you cry in life? He wipes them away. There's no death. There's no grieving. There's nothing to grieve. There's no crying. There's no pain. We cannot, by nature of who we are right now, even relate to that because we act and sometimes too much like we're too temporal. You realize heaven is non-temporal. It is eternal. It is lasting. It is non-spatial. It is not held to a gravitational system. It is held by the very nature of our God in heaven, the Father. So when you look at your heart right now, are you experiencing something new or are you clouded? Is your view of heaven clouded because you're caught up in the earth? Every believer longs for something new. That's why we're citizens of a different place. And even unbelievers, they catch shadows of this. They just haven't grabbed onto it. You see, in our humanistic thinking, everybody thinks we will pull ourselves up by our shoestrings and overcome all things. That's not what the Bible teaches. It teaches that every believer should live and show people on earth the kingdom of heaven. We fight for what is right, but there is a battle going on between good and evil. And guess what? The only one that's going to win that battle is not you or me. It is him through his work, and he uses us. He uses us. But we know better than to think, even if we get an antivirus, that it's the end of all disease. We know better that if we put out every fire right now, that there won't be more. We know better than even if we have whoever we want in office, that that's going to resolve everything. Because we know there's a place where everything does become resolved. Because we've had a taste of heaven through the Spirit of Christ in our lives. We've experienced something new. We are new creations. Live like it. In this world we're in right now, people need to see it. Our hearts have never yearned for a better Benicia, a better Vallejo, a better Cordelia. Do we want to make things better on earth? Yeah, but we want to show them a glimpse of the best place. We don't want to give them some secondary model to the real thing. We don't want to make them think that they could put all their hope in some earthly object or ideal. That's not heavenward. And yet, I am surprised that message is so stunted in our culture. You know, one of the biggest problems in our culture right now is that we don't believe in anything. That's the problem. A lack of belief. Notice what God says about this in verse 5 through 8. He said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious, the overcomers, as I would say, will inherit all this. I will be their God, and they will be my children. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters and the liars, they will be consigned, they will inherit the fiery lake of burning sulfur, the second death. It's pretty interesting here, isn't it? There is a place when justice is handed out completely. There is a place when the lines are drawn and the good and evil is dealt with and evil is done away with. There is a time when that happens. But when that happens, my friends, there is no grace to come back from the trial. Do you believe? You see, all these things that happen, whether fires, disease, politics, they test your belief, what you really believe in. Well, guess what gets people to heaven? Belief. But not any belief. Belief in Jesus Christ. Belief in God's nature. And belief in his grace in your life. You see, when it is done, the point is, when it is done, our Father will freely give every believer the inheritance of eternal life. And not just any life, he defined it. Remember, it's a life without tears, a life without suffering, a life which just, think about it. I don't know about you, the older I get, the more aches and pains. I had an ache in my neck this morning. I sat there and I thought, good grief, a life without pain, I can't even relate to it. Without suffering, without crying. I mean, what are we going to do? Some of you would be like, what in the world? So I feel like half my life has been in pain and suffering. Imagine. Just for a moment, take the most beautiful time in your life when you were doing something and literally your body was so healthy and so functional, you didn't even feel that part of the body. It was just doing its job and you were just joyous and happy, and compound that times a million and a million and one and beyond your wildest imagination, and you will find the joy of heaven, the joy of heaven. That's why Paul would say, listen, I'm here with you guys right now, but I am torn. It is so much better to be with Jesus. But the second death is there too. And that's why we're here. We want people to be aware there is a second death. People are crying out for things right now. And I want them to know there's an answer too. But I also want them to know something very serious and something very real. There is a second death. The inheritance for the wicked. And so many people crying out for things have yet set their own soul straight. They're not where they should be. Set your soul straight. Get your life in order, folks. Get your life in order before it is done. Get your life in order before it is done. You see, you're looking for the answers of eternity in this temporal place we live in. And what I'm telling you is, 100 years from now, if the Lord allows it, as it was 100 years ago, there will be stuff in this world because the world has fallen. And every humanist gets so disappointed in humanity because look what we do to each other. Look what we did to each other. Have we learned nothing of that? Does that mean we don't strive to make it better? No, as Christians, we're supposed to bring the kingdom of heaven where? That his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We fight for the will of God. We are in the battle between good and evil. And we know that good ultimately wins. But not everybody out there believes that, nor sees it, nor has the hope of it. And it's not just about winning a temporal battle on earth, my friends. It's about winning the battle of souls for belief. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? Do you believe in God the Father? Do you believe in heaven to come? You see, when we aim to live our lives in view of a new heaven and earth, we may start living like his kingdom is coming, and we may see a little bit of heaven on earth. Let me repeat that. If we aim to live our lives in a view of heaven and earth, we may start living like his kingdom is coming and see a little bit of heaven on earth. you get tastes of it. It's beautiful. You know, I sit there whenever I get a taste of heaven on earth. I sit there and I go, man, if you can have a little of it, is it potentially that there's a lot? Could there be a lot of heaven? Could there be a place where, like, this is it? All the time? And what if I told you there was a book where it's written down and explained, and it's shown in such a way that at least your imagination can begin to see something incredible, and then all of a sudden you realize, yes, it is possible. But then what happens is your pride and arrogance takes over. It's like, so that means we as people, we're the ones that should do it. We accomplish it. No, you can't create a rock. In fact, what I love is, I love this next picture. Jesus, when he died, he says, behold, I go and prepare a place for you, a place for us, for our hearts and souls and lives, so that where he is, we can be with him. So he's up there preparing places for us to be with him. But what's really cool about that is there's this city that is revealed in Revelation. It's in verse 21, in chapter 21, and it's right after what you just read. There's a section all the way to verse 26 about the city that is set apart. And it describes this city coming from heaven, okay, to this new earth, this new heaven and this new earth. And what I love about it is in Revelation 21:27, it says, nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And I want you guys this week to read the description of the new city. And the reason I say this has got to be a new heaven and a new earth, and some people say, well, it's just this earth kind of redefined. It could be. God could do whatever he wants, guys. Have fun with your imagination. And just remember this, though. However big your imagination gets, the reality of it will be bigger. But this city is described, and I'm just going to lay out one thing. This city is described as 1,400 miles square. The city itself, and we've all been in cities, the city itself runs from Benicia to Missouri, from Benicia to the southern tip of Alaska, and it runs 1,400 miles high, which means you realize space starts at 62 miles, some say 50, but it starts at 62 miles high. So this thing is over 1,300 feet in the space, 1,300 miles. In space. So either he does a crazy, freaky thing with this earth, or we got a whole new earth and heaven coming. But the magnificence is such a large place. And then the gates of this place are open all the time for all the nations, for all the people, all the cultures, everyone. It's open, and nothing impure enters it. Nothing impure enters it. Why? Because he's already dealt with the wicked. And I love the way it's said here where he says, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful. How many of us have done that to ourselves? How many of you have done things that are just shameful, deceitful? How much have you been watching and seeing, and you sit there and go, I don't know if that's, there's so much deceit and lies and misdirections and shameful things going on. Wouldn't it be nice to go to a place where when someone spoke, they spoke just truth? There was no hint of another agenda. Wouldn't it be beautiful? And how about that city, by the way? You got to read about it. Let your imagination go. But I would be happy, personally, if God takes us to heaven and he's preparing a place, and if that place is this city or some other place, let's just be honest, but if the streets are gold, wouldn't you be happy just being able to lay down one brick in the city? I mean, a glorious new place. Folks, the way you get there is found in the Lamb's Book of Life. The Lamb's Book of Life. Those who've raised in church, they know this means reference to Jesus being the Lamb of God that had to die for our sins. He had to suffer and die for our sins so that we might be saved and we might be written into the book of life. And what's fascinating to me about the Lamb's book of life is that it's the one that wipes away your deceit and your shame. It's the one that gets rid of all your sin. It's the one that makes you able to enter into heaven. Not just able, but it ultimately through his spirit and through his new body and his new life. When we get to heaven, folks, I can't wait to be in a body and in a soul where I don't do anything that's shameful or deceitful. I can't wait to live in a body that doesn't sin anymore. Imagine that. You know, you're not rude to someone. Even the small ones. It's not just big ones. It's not like I'm a murderer or something. But the reality is, it's the small stuff, too. Why do I do that to somebody? Why did I say that? You know, why did I think that? Imagine being a person who doesn't have any of that in them. That's why Jesus, when he spoke, he didn't speak to the head. He spoke to the heart. What comes out of the heart is what matters. Do you love everybody? Good grief, do you love everybody? It's challenging, isn't it? Especially for those people that do terrible things. Terrible things. David Jeremiah wrote a quote that I like. He says, you know, heaven is not a figment of our imagination. It's not a feeling or an emotion. It's not the beautiful isle of somewhere. It's a prepared place for a prepared people. I like that, man. I don't know if you picked this up yet or not, but you know, when Jesus is working in your life and the Spirit's working in your life, he's preparing you. And yeah, it hurts sometimes, and yeah, you get frustrated at this point, you get joyous and excited, but he's preparing you for heaven, man. He's preparing you for a time when you will be that way. Can you see yourself without any flaws? Or do you beat yourself up? You know, do you live in one of the great motivators like guilt, fear, shame? Those are done away with. Why would I fear my Father in heaven if I'm his child and he loves me? Why would I have guilt if all my sins are wiped away and all my tears? Why would I have shame when everything has been made right before God? Has the new come for you? Are you prepared? Has it come for you? 2 Corinthians puts it that if anyone's in Christ, they're a new creation. The old stuff that you did is gone. The new is coming, folks. It's come through his Spirit. It's a choice, you know, if we have the Spirit of God in us, it's a choice every day you wake up, whether you walk in a newness or not. Has the new come for you? Or are you acting like every other person in our culture or people? Are you buying into everything like everybody else instead of keeping focused on heaven? Where's your eyesight? Don't lose focus. Keep your eyes on Jesus. And Jesus is in heaven, and through his Spirit, his kingdom come, his will be done on earth through who? Us. Live like it. You see, there's one of two groups of people listening to this right now. One of them, the news come, but the issue that Paul raises at the very beginning, and I raise again, is I said, listen, are you living in that? Are you living in a way that represents the gospel of Jesus Christ? Has the new life that you've been given the life you are living? Or have the fires clouded your view? If you don't have the Spirit of God in you and you look at heaven and you see this picture of heaven, you sit there and go, I want to go there. Who doesn't want to go there? Really? But there are people that don't go there and don't want to go there. And they have what's called pride. Arrogance. I control my life. I'll finish my life. I'll do what I want with my life. You know what I love about the time we live in right now? That idealism of pride, arrogance, and self-control, but not self-control, but control, is just totally being wiped out right now. Oh, yeah, you have control of all these fires, not the virus, not politics, not. Do we have a vote? Yes. Do we have all these other things? Yes. Do we want them to go away? Yes. Do we want the right thing? Yes. But you have absolutely this much control. Your pride and your arrogance and your clouded vision of self-righteousness is what gets in the way. Because the people that get into heaven are humble, faithful, believing, trusting. Just to lay a gold brick in a gold street where there are no tears. But then there are answers to that question. Because it's interesting, right now there's also a group of you out there, and we're meeting you. It's exciting. I'm excited for you. There are some people out there right now that are longing to know the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the gospel of Jesus Christ tells you if you put your trust and your faith, and you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, that he will indwell you with his Spirit. You have to confess that, though. You have to say, Father, I'm not in control of this life. I want you to be in control of my life. I need your Spirit. I don't want to be driven by my Spirit. I need your forgiveness because I got a whole history of sins behind me. And even if people haven't seen them, they're the ones in the heart. You can have a new creation. That's the cool thing we bring. The fires eventually will stop. I pray the virus, there's an antivirus, I pray it stops. There will be elections. Stop. But the truth is, there's eternity that won't stop. And it's a choice you'll make even today. Below that form that you were pointed to earlier, if you need a new life and a new creation and a new view, if you need to see a little bit of heaven on earth, if you need eternal life, if you need salvation from your sins, if you're beginning to realize you don't control the world around you, and you're beginning to realize, but somebody must, then believe in the Lord Jesus Christ this morning and put your trust in him. And if you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you trust in him this morning, then conduct your life in a manner appropriate with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are citizens, yes, but we are citizens of another place. And this world will never hold up to the standards I have, ever, until God takes care of it. But what's beautiful is if I could just lay one gold brick in a gold street, where there are no tears. That's what I would love. Folks, there's hope. There's more than hope. There's heaven. And I am torn, but I find there to be joy here because I am here to represent Jesus for everybody on this planet. If you see me, hopefully my walk will back him through all this. You need Jesus. Believe. Believe in him today. Let's pray. Father, there's an incredible place that you are creating, you're preparing, and there's an incredible people, which I am privileged to be around, to be a part of, that you're preparing as well. And that place is heaven. And you're literally giving us an inheritance that's eternal. And it's hard to even imagine, but thank you so much for writing in Scripture just pictures that capture a little bit of it. Father, I know the trouble of this world will be settled eventually, and I know we have work to do here. But our primary work to begin with is these folks around us need salvation. So I pray if there are any of us who know Jesus and have friends who don't know you, neighbors that don't know you, that we would learn to conduct ourselves in a manner appropriate to the gospel. And Father, I know it would please you so much today. You would be so overjoyed to know of one person who would turn their life to you this morning because they want to put their hope in something that lasts. When so much of this earth fades, it is all temporal, but there is something eternal. And you built us to sort of have a shadow of that. We know that, but yet where is that? And Jesus, you showed us where we needed to go. So I pray that those who need to follow you would follow you this morning, and they would let us help them and encourage them. And in the joy of the Lord Jesus Christ that we celebrate this morning amidst all circumstances, we can stand up, we can praise you, we can have joy, because you are in charge. And you are in control. And there is nothing that we as people can do to prevent your will from happening. And so we just thank you because we just want to be a part of that golden street, that golden city, that beautiful place, and the love of Jesus in our lives. In your name, amen.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope and no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in when death was arrested and my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains, and my orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance, when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you. From my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you. Savior displayed on a criminal's cross, and darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins. free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, we're free, free forever, we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began, when death was arrested and my life began, oh, when death was arrested and my life began. I can see the promised land, though there's pain within the plan, there is victory in the end. Your love is my battle cry. When my fears like Jericho build their walls around my soul, when my heart is overthrown, your love is my battle cry, the anthem for all my life. Sing it out, every giant. Every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past you've broken into, over fear, over lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible with you. Whoa, whoa, there is hope within the fire, in the wars that wage inside. Though the shadows steal the light, your love is my battle cry, the anthem for all my life. And every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past you've broken into, over fear, over lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible. Every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past you've broken into, over fear, over lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible with you. Whoa, whoa, no greater name, no higher name, no stronger name than Jesus. You overcame, broke every chain, forever reign, King Jesus. No greater name, no higher name, no stronger name than Jesus. You overcame, broke every chain, forever reign, King Jesus. Every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past you've broken into, over fear, over lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible. Every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past you've broken into, over fear, over lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible with you. Whoa.